know you've been clearly on The Tonight Show many times, but on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson is a different story. Look, here's you doing stand-up.
Yeah, that's...
With Johnny Carson.
Well, and see, people of this generation wouldn't understand, but for a comic back then, that was Mount Everest. If Johnny liked you, you know, and so what you would do, and they would tell you before, you didn't know if you were coming to the chair, because you would perform, and they said, if Johnny doesn't like you, he'll clap. If he likes you, he'll give you, you know, good job. And if he loves you, he will wave you over to the chair. So you get to the end of the 6 minutes, you've been doing 500 shows a year, you know, and you're scared to look, because it's like Caesar, you know, does he live or does he die? And so, yeah, when
you didn't talk to him before the show. You
know? No, you never met. You walked through the curtain and looked and went, oh, my God, there's Johnny, you know.
Yeah.
So, and as you're doing your thing, he's kind of behind you, so you could hear him laughing, like, okay, I guess I'm doing okay.
Wow. And you turned out, boy, you definitely did okay.
Yeah, I made him laugh, you know?
Yeah, which is the best.
Yeah.
To make Johnny Carson laugh, that was the thing any comedian watching go, oh, wow.
Yeah.
It must be good if you made Johnny laugh. Yeah. And this, were you doing the redneck jokes here?
About right around that time I started to. I wrote the first one in 87, I think. So I've done the Page a Day calendar since 90, so 25 years.
Oh, my God.
And every year I'm like, there can't be 365 more of these.
But did you have any idea when you were doing it, you go, hey, this is going to be a super famous thing?
Oh, gosh, no, I'm not that smart. I had no idea. I didn't think about it being a hooker. But it was funny because, like, when I first started in comedy, I would come up to New York and play, like, Catch a Rising Star and Dangerfields. And all the New York guys were like, hey, Jeff, right, I don't want to hurt your feelings. You've got to take voice lessons and lose that stupid accent you got, you know?
Yeah, it's too stupid.
You talk real stupid the way you talk. I did have to learn to talk like that so every cab ride didn't cost $100. You know? So
they'll take
care. Because you get in the cab and go, can you take me to Times Square? Oh yeah, we go to Times Square. Yeah, we have to go over the bridge first. But I always wore jeans and boots, and they drove a truck, and so they would get Foxworthy, you're nothing but a redneck from Georgia. And so I'm playing in this club in Detroit. And after the show, they're kidding me about being a redneck. And the club is attached to a bowling alley that has valet parking. And I'm like, wait a minute. If you don't think you have rednecks, look out the window. People are valet parking at the bowling alley.
It's a gift from God.
Yeah, went back to the hotel and wrote 10 jokes. And, you know, never thinking it was a hook. And it went back the next night, and people started laughing and pointing at each other.
And your wife found the original jokes that you wrote on yellow...
Yeah, several years ago, she found it like the wadded-up piece of yellow paper, and she framed it. It's like next to the door of our house. And that's in our house, and I'm like, it's so ugly. She said, it paid for the house.
Absolutely, it did.
Yeah.
And they're great jokes.
Well, they're one-liners. We live in an age where nobody does one-liners, so they're so, you know,
Rodney, he's the greatest. But, I mean, I was reading some of these, and this is just...
They're so stupid.
No, they're so fun. If your mother keeps a spit can on the ironing board.
First one I ever wrote, yeah.
I love that so much. If your dog has a litter of puppies in the living room and nobody notices. And then this one, I just love it. If you have not trusted the Academy Awards ever since Jerry Reed was snubbed for Smokey and the Bandit.
He was snubbed.
He really was. Yeah.